Quantification in hybrid PET-CT imaging. Here my disclosure. Quantification is an important task in PET-CT imaging, but its accuracy is dependent on many factors. We will describe the image formation processes, the correction and calibration that can influence quantification, and we will introduce the main matrix used for quantification. Since the beginning, imaging PET was defined as the imaging modality able to lead to quantitative estimation of molecular and biological process in a patient. Information about the process can be extracted from the data in the images, and the process of interest may be the expression of a specific gene, the upregulation of a specific cell protein, the concentrations of receptors on a cell surface, the decrease in regional perfusion, the increase in glucose utilization, the decrease in oxygen consumption. Goal of a PET-CT assay is to lead to image reconstruction and accurate quantification of one or more of these processes. In this presentation, we will describe the general imaging practice and discuss steps and characteristics of equipment that are associated to accurate quantification of the listed processes. Positron emission tomography is a diagnostic nuclear imaging technique based on the use of radionuclides that decay by positron emission through a beta plus decay. These radionuclides, usually produced in a cyclotron, are used to label compounds of biological interest, and the labeled compound is administered to the patient, usually by intravenous injection, and is distributed in tissues according to its biochemical properties. The radioactive atom decays, emitting a positron that at the end of its path annihilates with the emission of two high-energy photons that have a good probability of escaping from the body. This is the scheme of annihilation. At the end of its path, the positron will combine with an electron in a process known as annihilation, in which the mass of the electron and of the positron is converted into electromagnetic energy. The two 500 and 11 keV photons are emitted along a line, but with opposite directions. The spatial reconstruction of the tracer distribution in the patient is based on the identification of this line that we call line of response. We said that annihilation produces two photons emitted simultaneously in opposite direction, carrying 511 keV each. Not all of them will reach the body surface, but if both photons escape from the body, they can be detected and localized externally. This means that the line joining the detectors that absorbed the two photons passes through the point of annihilation. Only the simultaneous record of the two high-energy photons is recognized by the electronic circuits and called coincidence. The events that are collected with any coincidence are not useful data for image reconstruction and should be discarded. Coincidences are collected along all the line of response covering the object in the scan field of view, in each axial position and across the axial field of view. The annihilation photons generated by the positron with the orbital electron are emitted at an angle that is not always exactly 180 degrees. It happens when the positron annihilates before losing all its kinetic energy, and we speak of positron annihilation in flight. This effect is known as no collinearity, and it degrades the accuracy of the line of response identification, introducing a small error that depends on the distance between the two opposite detectors. In practice, the inaccuracy due To this effect, all the coincidences have to be organized to be used for image reconstruction. PET data are organized in sinogram. How do we build the sinogram? We consider the line integral along all parallel lores at a specific angle. It forms a projection that depends on two parameters, the considered angle and the parameter S, that is the distance of each point in the projection from the center of the field of view. The projection at all angles around the object are then organized into a sinogram, which is a 2D function of S and the angle. Each projection is a line in the sinogram. The name sinogram comes from the fact that a single point traces a sinusoid in the projection space. This means that the global sinogram is the overlap of all sinusoids in the voxel in the object, weighted each by the amount of activity in each point. A PET scanner consists of rings of detectors that surround the patient body and are designed to convert the high-energy photons into electrical signal that can be fed to subsequent electronics. These events are corrected for a number of factors and then reconstructed into a tomographic image using mathematical algorithms. The output of the reconstruction process is a three-dimensional image volume where the signal intensity in any particular voxel is proportional to the amount of the radionuclide in the corresponding point of the patient body. The element used to detect the annihilation photons are scintillator, which properties will be described later in this presentation. The conversion of light into an electrical current occurs with the photomultiplier tubes or with the solid-state photodetectors. The PN tube have a very high gain, typically with a factor of about 1 million. They have low noise, fast response and relatively low cost. They normally require bias voltage between 800 and 1200 volts. The size of the PN tubes and their glass envelopes limited the ability to make high spatial resolution detectors, in particular with one-on-one coupling, one crystal to one photomultiplier tube, and led to the evolution of the block detector concept. However, much effort in the new detector design is centered around some alternatives to PN tubes. The desire to have option for one-on-one coupling with small crystal cross-sections, the use of photodetectors or multiple surfaces of a scintillator array or slab to further reduce the volume of the photosensor and to have detectors that can operate within magnetic fields led investigators to consider various forms of solid-state photodetectors. A complete PET system consists of a large number of crystals grouped in blocks placed in a circular ring geometry around the object the patient to be imaged. To improve efficiency, more than one ring are stacked one next to each other and the total axial field of view depends on the number of detector rings that we have in the scanner. The modern scanner can be scaled with different number of rings. From radioisotopes to spatial and quantitative distribution of the administered activity, many steps are performed sequentially. PET is based on the use of radioisotopes. They emit positrons. At the end of their path through annihilation, positrons energy mass together with the mass of an atomic electron is converted into energy of two photons, each with an energy of 511 kV. The two photons may or not interact with the patient body. and then impact on crystals. Interaction with the crystals produces scintillation light that is converted into electrical signals. Only coincidence events are used, and to each coincidence event a line of response is assigned. Finally, the sum of events lead to a spatial distribution of the administered activity in the patient body. Although quantification has been considered from the beginning one of the powerful characteristics of PET-CT, its potentiality are not completely developed, both in the technology and in acquisition or reconstruction tools, as the author of this paper declare. They say, over the last 30 years, a large amount of the physics and engineering effort in PET has been motivated by the dominant clinical application during the period that was oncology. This has led to important developments such as PET-CT, whole body PET, 3D PET, accelerated statistical image reconstruction, and time of flight PET. Despite impressive improvements in image quality as a result of these advances, the emphasis on static semi-quantitative hotspot imaging for oncological application has meant that the capability of PET to quantify biological relevant parameters based on tracer kinetic has not been fully exploited. Over the years, we have faced many advances in positron tomography that can be grouped in four main categories: advances in technology, mainly in gantry configuration; advances in production of radio tracers; advances in algorithm for data management and imaging reconstruction; and the introduction of new instruments of artificial intelligence. The purposes of these advances are usually to increase scanner performance in terms of sensitivity, spatial resolution, energy resolution, and time resolution. The effects of improvements lead to avoid movement artifacts, to reduce dose to patients, to reduce acquisition time, and all these bring to an improvement in lesion detectability and localization, and to a more accurate quantification. Here you can see some of the most impactful changes. From the very beginning of clinical scanner PET that were able to collect data in a 2D configuration in which the majority of the coincidences were absorbed by septa or discarded, and only those aligned with each axial slice contributed to image formation. It was an extremely inefficient system with which we need a long acquisition time for each bed field of view, and we obtained very noisy images with very low accuracy in quantitative evaluation. This transition was very fast to come, and I think that NanoView has never seen a scanner acquiring in 2D modality, but my first scanner PET in 2006 was able to acquire only in 2D, but it was very soon upgraded to a 3D acquisition modality, while my second scanner, PET-CT, less than 2 years later, was a 3D scanner, as 2D were no more available. PET-only scanners were short-lived and were quickly replaced by hybrid scanners. The poor spatial resolution and low contrast of PET images sometimes make the image reading difficult, also due to the lack of anatomical references, and the location of an uptake in a specific region or anatomical structure is important to lead to a correct diagnosis based on distinguishing the physiological uptakes from the pathological ones. Hybrid scanners increased the confidence of reporting and consequently the diagnosis and staging for patients. Standalone PET are no more available nowadays. Crystal dimensions is another important improvement that has been introduced in hardware. It is strongly associated to the introduction of digital detectors that have replaced almost completely the previous PN tubes. And both these changes have led to improvements in physical performances and in particular to better spatial resolution and very high sensitivity that both results in a more accurate quantification. The introduction of iterative reconstruction is another crucial step in the evolution of PET-CT imaging. In iterative reconstruction algorithm, the data are not pre-corrected, but the attenuation, the sensitivity maps, and also the estimation of scatter and random coincidences are inserted into the model and therefore into the reconstruction. In iterative reconstruction, the user has to select the number of iterations and the number of subsets in which data are divided. To reach the convergence between reconstruction and recorded data, we have to increase the number of iterations, but increasing this number, the number of iterations, has the effect to increase the noise in the reconstructed image. So, a third parameter has to be selected in clinical protocols, that is the low pass filter to reduce noise, that is a Gaussian filter. The higher is the value of the filter, the smoother is the image with less noise, but with the bias to lose detectability of small lesions. Different radionuclides are commonly used to label pharmaceutical compounds. Besides the possibility to use a particular atom to label a chemical compound that depends on the chemical properties, other physical characteristics are very important and have to be considered when using a particular radioisotope. We have to consider half-time, the maximum kinetic energy of the emitted positron, and the branch fraction of positron emission. Some of the isotopes that can be used only in those facilities that have a cyclotron, as their half-time is too short to allow shipping from the production center to other hospitals. Fluorine 18 radiopharmaceuticals like FDG F18 can be shipped and usually arrives every day in the amount needed to perform scanning of the day scheduled patients. Other can be produced in each center with a generator, like in the case of gallium 68, that can be produced not only in cyclotrons but also from the decay of germanium 68 in a specific generator. Positrons have a very short lifetime in materials that are rich of electrons, like is the biological tissue. So each positron rapidly loses its kinetic energy interacting with atomic electrons. We can calculate the positron range in water that depends on the initial kinetic energy that is different for the different radionuclides. The positron range correspond to the limit of the spatial resolution of PET imaging modality, as we can see in this picture, where on the top we see the fluorine 18 and on the bottom the oxygen 15, that has a positron range 5 times larger and led to a very wider spread of annihilation positions. In the table, other positrons emitting nuclides are listed, and for example for copper 62 and gallium 68 and rubidium 182, the positron range is much larger than that for fluorine 18. The connection between spatial resolution and radioisotope used to label pharmaceutical compounds for a given PET system has been studied by acquiring PET data using the same protocol and the same phantom, but with different radiotracers. In the publication from the agency, the Lidabrain phantom was filled with three different radiotracers, labeled with the positron emitters, and the maximum positron energy for these three radioisotopes is 0.6, 1.9 and 4.6 megaelectron volt, respectively, and the phantom was imaged on a dedicated brain-only PET system with the crystal of LSO. The increased blurring for gallium-68 and for iodine-120 compared to fluorine-18, that is very low energy positron emitter, is clear. According to the pharmaceuticals that are labeled with the listed radioisotopes, we can have many radiotracers. Some of them are commonly used, others are coming into practical applications, and some others have been studied in the past but never came into practice. Hundreds of papers have been presented with the results with different radiopharmaceuticals, and for example, in oncology application, more than 80 different tracers have been described, while in brain applications we find more than 30 radiopharmaceuticals that have been studied. As far as concern to improvements in reconstruction algorithms, we have seen many important developments since the system moved from the filter back projection to iterative reconstructions, with the possibility to model potentially any physical effect, starting from the noise into the mathematical calculations. Some of the most important are listed here and will be described in the following presentation. Performance of correction of point spread function, time of flight, noise modeling have been fully studied and many papers are published with the results improvements introduced by this correction in quantitative PET study. Nowadays, we are dealing with the introduction of artificial intelligence in many fields of our life. It is becoming very important in medicine and in particular in all diagnostic imaging modalities. In PET-CT, imaging AI is applied to almost every step of the process. We will see some application in data analysis, in noise modeling and image reconstruction. At the beginning of this talk, we have introduced the concept of coincidence. Coincidence events are recorded and used to reconstruct the spatial distribution of the radioactivity in the patient and are the basis for imaging this distribution and perform accurate quantitative evaluation. True coincidence are contaminated with undesirable events due to scatter or to random and multiple coincidences. All these events increase image noise and decrease image quality, and in quantitative studies decrease the accuracy. Scattered coincidences are recorded when one or both the annihilation photons undergo a Compton scatter interaction with the patient body before escaping from it and reaching the crystals. In scatter interaction, the photons change their energy and direction, and consequently, the line of response assigned to the coincidence events is not correct. The distribution of scatter contribute depends on the radioactivity distribution and on the shape of the scattering medium. The scatter fraction can range from 15 to 50% in typical PET studies, and as already said, it depends on size object and scanner characteristics like geometry and energy resolution. Scatter is one of the most challenging corrections to perform in PET. Another contribute that must be considered is due to multiple coincidences. At a high count rate, it is possible that three or more detectors are reached by annihilation photons at the same time. In this case, it becomes ambiguous where the event should be positioned. Because of this ambiguity, these multiple coincidences normally can be discarded. But in some circumstances, it may be better to randomly select and accept one of the possible line of response rather than completely discarding all the simultaneous events. The total number of events detected by the coincidence circuit in a PET scanner are referred to as prompt coincidences. They consist of true, scattered, and accidental coincidences. Only the true ones carry spatial information regarding the distribution of the tracer. It is therefore necessary to estimate what fraction of the measured prompt coincidences arise from the scattered and accidental coincidences for each line of response. Scatter correction can be performed in different ways. In the analytical method, the amount of scatter is estimated by fitting a smoothly function to the counts appearing outside the object in the sinograms. This method assumes that the scatter contribution varies very slowly across the field of view, and it is quite independent of both the source distribution and the scatter medium. Another way to account for scatter is the dual energy method, in which coincidences are acquired in two energy windows, for example 4 and 600 kilo-electron volt and 250 to 400 kV. The first energy window collects both scattered and unscattered photons. The second only the unscattered photons. The differences between them can be considered as an estimation of the scattered fraction. A third method is the simulation method. The uncorrected source distribution together with the attenuation map are used to simulate the scatter fraction and distribution. This is usually the most accurate correction method. Each vendor usually implements in reconstruction algorithm one of these methods, and the user is only allowed to activate or disactivate the scatter correction in the reconstruction of clinical study. Random coincidences, like scatter, lead to a loss in contrast and incorrect quantification. Also, the number of random events can be estimated and subtracted. The estimation can be performed recording the singles counting for a given detector and coincidence time window. A different approach is to directly measure the accidental coincidences with a parallel coincidence circuit that is delayed in time such that the detector pair cannot produce any true coincidence. Any coincidence recorded by this second circuit can only be caused by accidental coincidences in a prompt circuit, and can be estimated and subtracted. Here an example of image with and without scatter correction, in which it is really evident the improvement of image quality with the application of the correction. It is also evident the change in intensity of the uptake leading to different quantification, in particular in the abdominal regions. Each detector has its sensitivity that may vary according to the characteristic and also to the age. To take account of this variability, the detector's response is corrected by a factor that is calculated with the calibrated source. This is the single correction. To obtain accurate quantification for PET for a given injected dose of radioactivity, the system must have a very high efficiency in detecting high energy photons that escape from the patient's body. The more photons pair are detected, the better is the ratio between the signal and the background, the signal to noise ratio. Moreover, it is very important to reach precise information on the spatial location of the interaction. These performance characteristics are expressed by the sensitivity of the scanner, that is, its ability to detect positrons, by the spatial resolution, that is, the ability to distinguish between two sources' points after image reconstruction, and both these physical characteristics are strongly associated to the crystal type and dimension. The elements used to detect the annihilation photons are scintillator crystals. The high energy photon interacts with the crystal and releases its energy to the scintillator. As a consequence, low energy optical photons are emitted and produces an electrical pulse. Early PET scanners were based on the use of sodium iodine scintillators together with photomultiplier tubes. Scintillator-based design remain the most common primary detector for PET scanners and are a very active area of development. The introduction of LSO, followed by other lutetium compounds, provided designers with a series of fast, bright, and dense scintillators. These lutetium scintillators are more expensive than sodium iodine or BGO to grow, but they do offer performance options unobtainable with the older scintillators. The crystals should be very efficient for interaction with 511 keV photons. The conversion of energy into light should be very efficient, should give very precise information on spatial location that depends on crystal dimension, and should be able to distinguish the photon's energy. That means they should have a good energy resolution. To assess the properties of the different types of crystals that can be used, we consider their intrinsic efficiency, that is, the efficiency in detecting the high energy photons that are incident on their surface. We can also consider the effective atomic number and the probability for photoelectric effect, that means for photon absorption, is proportional to a power of 4 of the effective atomic number and is inversely proportional to a power of 3 of the photon energy. The higher is the probability for the photons to interact, the more the detector is efficient, and the better is the signal-to-noise ratio and the quantitative evaluation as well. Another parameter that is considered to describe the crystal properties is the energy resolution. An ideal spectrum would have the energy of the scattered photons separate from the peak of the annihilation photons that escape from the patient body without interacting with it. In the real spectrum, these two parts are not separate, and the energy resolution is defined as the width at half of the maximum in the peak. The possibility to accurately recognize the energy of the photons is important to discard scatter fraction and improve noise. The detector must allow precise localization of the event, which is directly related to the spatial resolution of the image. It should also be enough thick to completely absorb the incoming photons. The detector must provide also precise information on the moment in which the photon impacts, in order to allow the comparison between all the times of the recorded events and the consequent identification of coincidence. Typical temporal resolution are between 6 and 18 nanoseconds. The detector must work at high counting rates, so they need to have short scintillation decay times, also useful for ensuring adequate temporal resolution for coincidences. In this table are listed the main characteristics of different scintillators used in nuclear medicine equipment. BGO has a good effective number, zeta, and mean free path of annihilation photons, but it has a very high decay time that make it impossible to correct for time of flight. On the other hand, LSO and LISO have worse effective numbers and linear attenuation, but they have very good decay times and they are used in time of flight scanners. This correction will be described in the next presentation. The general performances of a scanner PET are influenced by all these elements and characteristics described up to here. Type, number, and dimensions of crystals, as well as detector type and gantry architecture in terms of number of rings, axial and transaxial field of view, are in general the characteristics that are influencing the performances. Scanner performances can be summarized by a few physical parameters that can be measured according to their definition. The first physical parameter that we consider is the system ability to distinguish between two points after image reconstruction. This is the spatial resolution of the scanner. It is usually measured along different directions and in different positions in the axial and transaxial field of view, acquiring point sources and measuring the full width at half maximum in the profile drawn along the different positions and directions. Sensitivity of a positron emission scanner is expressed as the rate in counts per second that true coincidence events are detected for a given source strength. It changes according to the position along the axial field of view, being the maximum value in the center and the minimum at the edges. This particular shape of the sensitivity profile through the axial field of view is taken into account in clinical acquisition protocols as an adequate overlap between beds position should be considered. In the image, we can see the effect of a not adequate overlap in the acquisition. The effect of the sensitivity profile is evident. Sensitivity is measured in counts per unit of activity. As described at the beginning, the scattering of gamma rays emitted by the annihilation of positrons results in falsely located coincidence events. Variation in design and implementation cause positron emission tomograph to have different sensitivities to scattered radiation. The measurements of count losses and random rates express the ability of the scanner to measure highly radioactive sources. To achieve quantitative measurements of source activity distribution under widely varying conditions, positron emission tomograph usually have a capability to compensate for dead time losses and random events. The accuracy of these corrections, particularly at highest count rates encountered in clinical imaging, is reflected by the bias with which the tomograph reports counts. The purpose of this measurement is to produce image simulating those obtained in a total body imaging study with both hot and cold lesions. We need a standard and general way to establish the performances of a scanner PET that could allow also the comparison between different scanners. In the NIMA protocols, standard setting for measuring the described parameters are proposed, and many papers have been published describing the results of NIMA tests on different scanners or comparing their results. In clinical applications, we need a quantitative evaluation of activity distribution in tissues or organs. The standardized uptake value is a semi-quantitative measure of the tracer uptake in a region of interest that normalizes the lesion activity to the injected activity and a measure of a volume of distribution, usually total body weight or lean body mass. F18-FDG distribution is very low in fat, which leads to higher values in tumor and normal tissues in heavier patients than in thin patients. Correction applied for body mass or body surface area can eliminate this problem, and we introduce the SUV lean or SUV BSA. SUV in a region can be evaluated as SUV max, the pixel in the region lesion that show the highest value, SUV min, the mean value in a selected region, the SUV peak, the mean value in a standard dimension region, usually 1 cm³ voxel. It depends on many factors: the patient size, the measure time, the plasma glucose, the partial volume effect, the scanner performances, the activity measure accuracy. Standardized uptake value, SUV, is commonly used as a relative measure of FDG F18 uptake, and for example in pretreatment of oncological patients, it is considered a prognostic factor for risk stratification. However, it is significantly influenced by tumor heterogeneity and image noise because it is measured in a single voxel. Repeated tumor SUV max measurements may show an intra-patient variations of 5% to 30%. To overcome this drawback of SUV, two metabolic tumor volume MTV and total lesion glycolysis TLG measures that reflect metabolism, volume and activity respectively have been proposed as quantitative indexes of tumor metabolism. These indexes are prognostic factors for survival in various solid cancers. Metabolically active volume of a tumor segmented MTV is a measurement of the tumor volume with high metabolism, while total lesion glycolysis is defined as the product of the mean SUV and the MTV. Measuring MTV is easier and faster than tumor volume measurement from anatomic imaging. On the other hand, the optimal segmentation method to measure these values has not been established, and these values are significantly affected by segmentation methods. A multitude of segmentation algorithms have been described in the literature, but as of now, there is no consensus on the optimal or most accurate algorithm, and hence there is no universally accepted, reproducible, and practical method for segmentation. The comparison of different segmentation methods is challenging because a ground through does not exist. The variability in MTV delineation by different segmentation algorithms have been reported in the range of 40% to 400%. To define the boundaries of the region of interest for MTV calculation, different users or algorithm methods have been studied. SUV from 2 to 5 have been reported as possible threshold for MTV calculation. 2.5 value has shown consistently good predictive value and prognosis in many studies and applications. In threshold-based methods, the image is partitioned into tumor and background using a different threshold value that mean that all the voxels above that value are assigned to the tumor and, on the other hand, voxels with values below threshold belong to the background. Quantitative values in PET are variable depending on technical, biological and physical factors. The variability may have a significant impact on a study outcome, and appropriate scanner calibration and quality control, standardization of imaging protocols, and any necessary harmonization strategies are essential to make use of PET as a biomarker with low bias and variability. The Centiloid scale CL is an example of popularly used data-driven harmonization methods. The CL is an harmonized quantitative metric for amyloid PET proposed by Klang. The standard CL is calculated from the standardized uptake value SUVR of amyloid PET as follows, where the SUV of a patient in study is compared to the average value of SUV calculated on a group of healthy patients. To choose the best method to calculate MTV is not simple, as many different methods are available, each with advantages and disadvantages. In this paper, the proposed MTV calculations are described and compared. Using a fixed absolute value of SUV, for example values between 2 or 5, is a simple method with high reproducibility and no dependence on the observer. But it is, on the other hand, arbitrary and could lead to overestimation in tumor where there is an intense FDG uptake. The fixed relative threshold has the same advantages of the fixed absolute threshold, but it leads to underestimation when there is a high heterogeneity. The adaptive method has the advantage to be a patient and scan-based threshold, but it has very low reproducibility. Other methods for MTV calculation have been proposed using statistical modeling or machine learning techniques. When choosing a method, we have to consider its simplicity, its accuracy, but also the possible limits and disadvantages with the specific type of patients or tumors that are under investigation. Quantification in PET is strongly influenced by many factors. First of all, by scanner performances, but also by clinical protocols that are used to acquire clinical studies, and by procedures and instruments that are used to measure activities. When there's a need to compare results from different scanners in different PET centers, an harmonization program was introduced. EARL set up an accreditation program for FDG F18 PET CT imaging and launched it in July 2010. The aim was to help imaging sites to meet the recommendations indicated in the European guideline, to harmonize scanner performances and minimize the effect of most of the technical factors that are affecting SUV variability. From the first program that was designed for quantitative harmonization of studies using F18 labeled tracers, EARL harmonization program has been updated over years to adapt to state-of-the-art PET-CT technology and also to include other tracers. According to EARL, all zirconium 889 reconstructions for quantitation when referring to EARL accreditation should be done using the approved parameters for F18. EARL accreditation procedure starts with the acquisition of uniform cylindrical phantom for calibration and the second acquisition of the image quality phantom with the reconstruction parameters that are used for clinical studies. The second step is to review the submitted images and eventually instruction or changes needed to meet the standard are applied. Then we will perform new acquisitions with the changed protocol and if everything is within the acceptable limits, the new protocol will be used for clinical patients acquisitions. For EARL acquisition of a calibration QC, we need a calibrated dose calibrator, some water or distilled water to fill the phantom, a cylindrical calibration phantom that is a 20 cm diameter cylindrical phantom with a length enough to cover the axial field of view. Finally, we have a syringe with a precise known activity. Preparing activity and filling the phantom, we need to record time at activity measure, at injection and at acquisition. Calibration phantom and the image quality phantom should be acquired with the standard clinical protocols and all the corrections that are used in routine are applied as well. The corrections that can be used are the corrections already mentioned that have been described or will be described in the next presentation, and in particular we will apply attenuation correction, scatter correction, normalization, decay correction, dead time correction, if possible time of flight, point spread function or other. A summary of accreditation results of different scanners all over Europe have been published, with a relevant increase in the number of centers that have been certified scanners. Results show that often the first submitted data do not meet the requested conditions and need a review of the clinical protocols. Quantification are out of the tolerance range in both sides, some values are smaller and some other are above the upper limit, while after corrections and changes in protocol, they all lay inside the acceptance range. Scanners from all vendors after correction of clinical protocols manage to reach the goal. Finally, we introduce another method that is used to analyze in a scientific way images for brain pathologies. SPM is a statistical parametric mapping of brain images based on voxel-specific statistical analysis to evaluate brain responses without knowing where those responses are expressed. SPM allows to study the relation between global or local changes in different imaging modality. It is commonly used in PET, in SPECT, in MRI imaging. SPM has replaced the manual selection of region of interest in the statistical analysis of variance. The analysis performed can be summarized in the following two subsequent phases: a pre-processing part in which image of any modality is aligned, data are smoothed with a kernel function, and also spatial normalization is applied to meet the standard geometrical characteristics of reference images. Then the general linear model is applied and a parametric map is used to identify abnormal values that can be recorded as a single voxel or cluster of voxel abnormalities. In pre-processing, alignment has the purpose to eliminate any error due to the movement of the patient. The spatial normalization converts images to a standard space so that in the single voxel analysis, data from a specific voxel can be compared to the corresponding region in the reference space. This normalization is very important to get correct results. In the smoothing process, each experimental value is replaced by a weighted average value calculated with the neighboring voxels. This is a SPECT example of brain acquisition that is first reoriented to meet the orientation of the template SPECT, then spatial normalization is applied, and finally, after normalization and smoothing, we have the set of the images that are compared to the template. In the statistic analysis, we first specify a model to describe the experimental data and design the metrics of this model. Then we estimate the model parameter with the use of the general linear model. We have the contrast definition and a statistical test to identify active regions outlined by the model. And finally, we get the results that are both graphic and numeric results. Thank you for your attention.